Gloria in excelsis Deo, et in terra mater dominibus, omne voluntatis, ad honoribus te, et in principibus te, ad honoribus te, glorificamus te, gratias magibus tibi, propter omnium gloriam tuum. Domine Deus excelestis, Deus pater omnipotens, Domine Filii unigenite, Deus Omnipotens, Domine Deus Magnus Dei, Filibus Matris, Christus peccata mundi, miserere nobis, quodiam tus omnes sanctus, tus omnes omnibus, tus omnes omnibus, tibus, Deus puro Christe, cum sanctorum spiritum, in gloria Dei gratis. Amen. Let us pray. O God, who on this day through your only begotten Son have conquered death and unlocked for us the paths of eternity, grant, we pray, that we who keep the solemnity of the Lord's resurrection may, through the renewal brought by your Spirit, rise up in the light of life. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Amen.
A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. Peter proceeded to speak and said, "You know what has happened all over Judea, beginning in Galilee after the baptism that John preached, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and power. He went about doing good and healing all those oppressed by the devil, for God was with him. We are witnesses of all that he did, both in the country of Judah, Jews, and of Jerusalem. They put him to death by hanging him on a tree. This man God raised on the third day and granted that he be visible not to all the people, but to us, the witnesses chosen by God in advance, who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. He commissioned us to preach to the people and testify that he is the one anointed by God. as judge of the living and the dead. To him all the prophets bear witness that everyone who believes in him will receive forgiveness of sins through his name. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad.
This is the day.
Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his mercy endures forever. Let the house of Israel say, his mercy endures forever.
This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad.
The reason the Lord has struck with power, the right hand of the Lord is exalted. I shall not toil at thee, and you bear the works of the Lord.
This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad.
The stone which the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. For the Lord has his hand up. It is wonderful in our hearts.
This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad.
A reading from the first letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. Brothers and sisters, do you not know that a little yeast leavens all the dough? Clear out the old yeast, so that you may become a fresh batch of dough, inasmuch as you are leavened. For our Paschal lamb, Christ, has been sacrificed. Therefore, let us celebrate the feast, not with the old yeast, the yeast of malice and wickedness, but with the unleavened bread of sincerity and truth. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Christians to the Paschal victim, offer your thankful praises. Of the sheep redeemer, Christ to
have mercy, Victor King. On the first day of the week, Mary of Magdala came to the tomb early in the morning while it was still dark and saw the stone removed from the tomb. So she ran and went to Simon Peter and to the other disciple whom Jesus loved and told them, "They have taken the Lord from the tomb. And we don't know where they put him." So Peter and the other disciple went out and came to the tomb. They both ran, but the other disciple ran faster than Peter and arrived at the tomb first. He bent down and saw the burial cloths there, but did not go in. When Simon Peter arrived after him, he went into the tomb and saw the burial cloths there, and the cloth that had covered his head, not with the burial cloths, but rolled up in a separate place. Then the other disciple also went in, the one who had arrived at the tomb first, and he saw and believed, for they did not yet understand the scripture that he had to rise from the dead.
The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Wanting to begin by extending to everyone a blessed Easter, praying and hoping that amidst our circumstance that I look out at empty pews and that those of you who are able, and please God, our live stream is working better today. I don't see the little ribbon that says our connection is weak, so that's a good sign, even though it did pop up once already, I noticed, and kind of winced at it as I did. But the truth is that we want to still find joy in this day, even if my own tone is a little bit tense right now, and it's for several reasons which may come out in this homily. But one of the realities that I hear in our gospel today, as it's being proclaimed actually, is one of confusion. Mary Magdalene arrives at the tomb, and she is confused. They have taken the Lord from the tomb, and we don't know where they put him. And likewise, Simon Peter, the beloved disciple, they run to the tomb, and while the beloved disciple believes Simon Peter, it doesn't express that he himself believed, because as John himself says in this passage, they did not yet understand the scripture that he had to rise from the dead. A very direct speaking to the confusion that was found. And brothers and sisters in Christ, I don't think it's too much of a stretch to think that right now we are living in a time of great confusion, not just because of coronavirus and the measures that have been taken by governments, and for that matter, the church following in that step of seeking to keep people isolated from one another so that the disease doesn't spread. But there's a confusion about how God might be in all this. There are those who want to most likely say, ah, see that? There's no God. Then there are probably others out there that are saying, well, why does God let this happen? He must not be a loving God. If he truly loved us, he would prevent this or vanquish it so that we could all rightly worship him on a day of such great importance as Christians. And in truth, there are probably many other kinds of thoughts along these same lines. But the truth is, Jesus has already won victory. And this is what we testify to on this Easter Sunday and every Easter Sunday, and in truth, every Sunday, as a remembering of Jesus' resurrection. He has already won. This is why we keep this day as a feast, and not just Easter Sunday again, but every Sunday we are called to enter into his rest. Why? Because he himself has accomplished our salvation, and we are invited to rest in him, to be remade, recreated in him. Hence the word recreation, to be drawn to our true way of life. Is this not what every Sunday, in particular this Easter Sunday, can and truly ought to be? In the midst of confusion, in the midst of tensions of this world, in the midst of our busyness that we all tend to lean into when we don't live up to our own personal resolutions to follow Jesus Christ, or for that matter, what the church lays before us as the narrow gate through which to pass. We lean into these excuses, as they can be, worldly understandings of what we think our life is truly meant to be, when it is quite the contrary, that Jesus, who has come into the world, has taken on our human flesh with all of its weaknesses and tensions and, yes, even the busyness of our lives. He's taken all of it upon himself. And where did he carry it? He carried it on that Via Dolorosa, as it is called, that way of the cross. And it was nailed to the tree on Calvary forever to be put to death with him, so that we could have a new life in him. And this is where our second reading today, beyond just the imagery of St. Paul of the little yeast that leavens the whole batch of dough, and the casting out of the old yeast, that of wickedness and malice, and having a fresh batch of unleavened bread, where it is Jesus himself who is the true leaven, reigns and dwells within us and gives us new life, no longer looking backwards to what was or how we were before this time, but only forward to what is true and what is life-giving. This is what we are called to this day. And so in the midst of it all, might I, a perhaps vain attempt to recapture something of what was said in last night's Easter Vigil, in the midst of a spotty live stream, might I invite us to consider quite simply, but quite profoundly, the love that Jesus Christ has for us this day, that cuts through the confusion, that cuts through those who want to ridicule us as being somehow not with it because we still hold to a faith in Jesus Christ when the world as we know it is in chaos and the confusion that it is. To let Jesus love us where we are, to recognize on one level each of us together as one body in Christ are still being strengthened and nourished by his cross and resurrection, even in the midst of our collective suffering at this time and being isolated and separated from one another. But let's go deeper. Let's consider the love of Jesus Christ and something in drawing from last night's vigil. The vigil, of course, contains seven readings from the Old Testament, representative of God's creative works, of his redeeming works, of his giving a covenant to his people, and of his fidelity to that covenant, that even when his people strayed, he was willing to bring them back to himself, to heal them of their sinfulness, to give them new life. This is the depth of his love that he expressed even in the Old Covenant. And as is St. Paul's words, how the glory of Christ risen from the dead, the previous glory was as no glory at all because of that love that Jesus expresses for us. Imagine how each of us can truly open ourselves to encounter Jesus and his love, page after page of the scriptures, as he reveals himself to us, and then not be afraid then to bring him every burden, every confusion, every failure, whatever it is that holds us back from letting Jesus love us, give it all over to him this very day, and then not be afraid to confront these matters. Because the more we give it to Jesus, the more we truly become everything he made us for, which is not death, but life, life in his presence in heaven. And so if we are burdened with unforgiveness this day, whether it is unforgiveness of a neighbor or unforgiveness of God, because truly that can happen too, where we hold God in resentment because of misfortunes in this life, give it over to him. Maybe we're having a hard time forgiving ourselves of something that happened perhaps decades ago when we were much younger and not as wise or prudent about our lives as we wish we would have been at that time. Give it over to him. Let him take it. And perhaps, too, there are these moments in our life today that are times of tension, that we think that Satan has the upper hand, let's say, and that we are weighed down and that there's no getting out from underneath this one. Well, remember this about Easter Sunday, that when they went to the empty tomb, that God the Father had raised Jesus up from the dead, and the whole time, start to finish, from the time of creation to the time of Jesus' coming in the flesh, to the time of his being arrested and led away to his crucifixion and death, to the time of the resurrection, through the 2,000 years of the church, and until the end of time, whatever that may look like for us going forward and for generations to come, God the Father holds it all in his hands, and the victory is already won. And this is why Jesus confidently, not necessarily without being weak in moments, we of course remember the Garden of Gethsemane, but he confidently gave himself over to the will of the Father, because the whole of salvation history has been in the Father's hands, and it is the Father who raised Jesus up from the dead this very day, and it is the Father who will continue to love us and bring us through this time with his Son, Jesus Christ, having already won that victory for us, with the Holy Spirit coming into the world to dwell among us, though of course in our own religious commemoration, we now are in this time of Jesus risen and awaiting his ascension, and eventually we will celebrate the Holy Spirit properly in his own coming on Pentecost. But in all of these things, it is God the Father who is the source, and he holds us in his hands as the perfect Father and loves us beyond our comprehension to truly fathom. Don't be afraid to give yourself to him, to let him love you where you are. Place all your burdens upon him, and may we in due time be brought together again, because we do not know what's going to happen in the days or weeks to come. Why worry about that? Let Jesus love us today. Let him be our source of joy. Let us feast in the Lord. And as all of you, in your own privacy, because as I read in the Missal here, it says, in masses without a congregation, the creed is said. And so we are going to, in this Mass, simply go right into the creed, rather than the normal renewal of our baptismal promises, as we typically do on Easter morning. But so you have at your disposal those prayers on our parish website, to be able to do this in your own privacy, and to sign yourself with holy water, which hopefully you have available to you in your home, and to truly let Jesus love you where you are, because indeed he has been raised up, and he cuts through all the confusion and shows us the perfect life for which we are made, which is not a life in this world, it is a life in the eternal kingdom, in the fullness of the life of the Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father, through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary, and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate, he suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. We place our trust in our Heavenly Father, who holds all things in his hands, and who has willed for his Son to die and be raised up for our salvation, as we give to him our prayers of petition.
That the Church may visibly and courageously proclaim the truth of Christ's triumph over death, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all governments to humbly acknowledge God in this moment and to appeal to his power and love for guidance, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the sick and those who care for them, for their being strengthened to trust in God's healing power, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That the event of Easter will deeply change our lives, renewing our families and blessing us with the new beginning that comes from God's merciful love, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the intention of this Mass, which is for the repose of the soul of Alexander E. Van Horn, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
And that all who have died, especially members of our families, may come to the fulfillment of Christ's victory over death in the resurrection and life of heaven. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray our diocesan vocation prayer. Almighty Father, we beg you for an increase in religious vocations and holy marriages in our diocese. Help us to be generous in our response to your call. Choose from our homes those who are needed for your work, and strengthen us with the courage to say yes and to follow you. Help us as a diocese, as a parish, as families to encourage and foster vocations to priesthood, permanent reactant, and consecrated life. We commend our prayers for our patroness, Mary, Queen of the Rosary, and ask this for Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We pray, Almighty Father, you grant for our diocese a holy and faithful bishop. Amen. Amen. Brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and good of all this holy church.
Exalted with paschal gladness, O Lord, we offer the sacrifice by which your church is wondrously made one and fresh through Christ our Lord. Amen. And with your spirit, lift up your hearts. We lift them up to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and just. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, at all times to obey you, O Lord, but on this day of all, to lie forget your gloriously, when Christ our Passover has been sacrificed. For he is the true Lamb who has taken away the sins of the world. By dying, he has destroyed our death, and by rising, restored our life. Therefore, overcome with paschal joy, every man, every people exalts in your praise, and even the heavenly powers, with the angelic hosts, sing together the unending hymn of your glory, as they obey.
For themselves and all who are dear to them, for the redemption of their souls,
in full health and well-being, paying their homage to you, the eternal God, living and true. Celebrating the most sacred day of the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ in the flesh, and in communion with those whose memory we venerate, especially the glories of the Virgin Mary, Mother of our God and Lord Jesus Christ, the Blessed Joseph and spouse, the Blessed Apostles and Martyrs, Peter and Paul, Andrew, James, John, Thomas, James, Philip, Bartholomew, Matthew, Simon, and Jude, Linus, Cletus, Clement, Sixtus, Cornelius, Cyprian, Lawrence, Misogynus, John and Paul, Cosmas and Damian, and all your saints. We ask that through their merits and prayers, in all things we may be defended by your protecting help. Christ our Lord, amen. Therefore, Lord, we pray, graciously accept this oblation of our service, that of your whole family, which we made to you, also for those to whom you have been pleased to give the new birth of water and the Holy Spirit, granting them forgiveness of all their sins. Order our days in your peace. Command that we be delivered from eternal damnation, and count them on the flock of those who have chosen. Christ our Lord, amen. Make it spiritual and acceptable, so that it may become for us the body and blood of your most beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. On the day before he was to suffer, he took bread in his holy and venerable hands. With eyes raised to heaven, to you, O God, his almighty Father, giving you thanks, he said a blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you.
We please look upon these offerings with a serene and kindly countenance, and to accept them as much you are pleased to accept the gifts of your servant Abel Just, the sacrifice of Abraham, our father of faith, and the offering of your high priest Melchizedek, but for the sacrifice of spotless again. In humble prayer we ask, O Holy God, command that these gifts be borne by the hand of your holy angel, and all our minds that your divine majesty, so that all of us who through this participation at the altar receive the most holy body and blood of your Son, may be filled with the grace of heavenly blessing. Christ our Lord, amen. Remember also, Lord, your servants who have gone before us with the sign of faith. And now, Lord, we pray that all who sleep in Christ a place of refreshment, light, and peace. Christ our Lord, amen. Bless also your servants, who those sinners, both in your own mercies, graciously grant and share in fellowship with your holy apostles and martyrs, with John the Baptist, Stephen, Matthias, Barnabas, Ignatius, Alexander, Marcellinus, Peter, Felicity, Perpetua, Agatha, Lucy, Agnes, Cecilia, and Anastasia, and all your saints. Bid us with the saints you in their company, not waiting on merits, but granting us your pardon for Christ our Lord, to whom you continue to make all these good things, O Lord. Sanctify them, fill with life, bless them, and bestow them upon us.
Is ever, 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 My Jesus, I believe that you are present in the most holy sacrament. I love you above all things and desire to receive you into my spirit. Since I cannot at this moment receive you sacramentally, at least come spiritually into my life. I embrace you as if you were already there, and unite myself wholly to you. Never permit me to be separated from you.
To glory, the glory of all his own children.
through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Please know my continued prayers for everybody. May you have a blessed Easter day. Truly, would this be a new beginning of deeper trust in our Lord, reliance upon Him? Because God has got us after all, so we place our trust in Him. The Lord be with you
and with your spirit.
Bow down for the blessing. Defend you from every assault of sin. And may He who restores you to eternal life in the resurrection of His only begotten endow you with the prize of immortality. Now that the days of the Lord's Passion have drawn to a close, may you who celebrate the gladness of the Paschal Feast come with Christ's help and exulting in spirit to those feasts that are celebrated in eternal joy.
Amen.
And may the blessing of Almighty God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit come down on you, remaining with you forever.
Amen.
Go in peace, alleluia. Alleluia.
Thanks be to God, alleluia.
Yeah.
Glory is all.